So, out of curiosity, I was told that Canvas is down today, which is a bummer for everybody. Have you had an opportunity to start reading Kant's Prolegomena to any future metaphysics? And what are we thinking so far? I don't mean to like freak anybody out by kind of doing this whole big warning about like it's very hard. And maybe you haven't encountered that yet, because you're reading the Bennett translation, which is designed to make it as easy as possible. There are certainly other translations that try to hew a little more to the original text and don't really care how easily it is to read. They mostly care about like how accurately are we translating things. Senses so far from folks who have been reading it like was I kind of woo, it's very hard. Like, did you experience that? It's heavy. All right, it is heavy. And as we go on, it's gonna get denser. I think I mentioned at our last meeting that like there's a very good possibility, and I hope, actually for your sake, I hope this is true, that this is gonna be the hardest thing that you read as a student, which is gonna put it like pretty high in the ranking for like the hardest thing that you're probably gonna read in your entire life. The upside to that is like if you can get through that, like you can get through anything. The other questions that might kind of pop up is like, well, why? Like, why would I make you read this like crazy bananas difficult stuff? And we might even get to questions about like why is it so difficult as well? Because he's a terrible writer is what not just you but several of like my several of my philosophy friends say. And sometimes I'm inclined to be like, you take that back right now. He's not a terrible writer.
He admits that Hume is like the most elegant writer.
Yeah, that Hume was the most elegant writer that he had ever come across. I think that's probably true. Hume of the Enquiry, at least.
He was at least saying that like he's doing something way better than I am.
So yep.
He's not the best writer.
I don't think Kant would ever say like I am a good writer. And we might even raise this question like, what does it mean to be a good or a bad writer as well? Like writing is a technology. And technology, like whether or not a technology is good or bad, it seems to hinge on what purpose we intend to put it to. If what our plan is to make ideas accessible, then I suppose that we have certain ideas about what writing is supposed to be like. Clear, right? Clear writing, concise writing. Distinct, yeah, clear and distinct writing, right? Writing that's fun, writing that isn't like painful or a chore. Yeah, for sure. On the other hand, if what we're trying to do is convey how to work through ideas that are incredibly complicated, if we do that in such a way that renders them to not be complicated at all, maybe we're just not representing those ideas accurately. It's entirely possible that Kant is so difficult to read, not because he's a bad writer, although he might, in fact, be a very bad writer. Yeah, he might be writing in the only way that, like, you can write about this stuff. The ideas themselves, the ideas are difficult. And in fact, in plenty of places, Kant says, and this is maybe a bit of a rhetorical device, there are places where Kant says, on purpose, I made this stuff difficult to read, which we might say, like, why? Like, why would you do that? Why would you make it difficult to read? And Kant's answer is, to prevent people from misunderstanding it. Now, it turns out that didn't really turn out. But his idea here is that, like, when something is easy to read, people read it and they're just like, oh, I understood that. Whereas like if you read Kant, very few people are inclined to, like if you get a secondhand version of Kant, if somebody says, this is what Kant says, you might walk away being like, I know what Kant says. If you read Kant himself, if you read the primary source texts, very few people walk away from those texts thinking to themselves, oh, I know what he's talking about. And if you're not that confident that you know what somebody's talking about, you're not that inclined to misrepresent their ideas. You're not that inclined to dismiss them out of hand. And so Kant, to a certain extent, is doing that on purpose. He's making the writing difficult to make sure that like you actually wrestle with the ideas. I think that there's something, this is gonna sound maybe paternalistic. This might elicit some eye rolls. I think that there's something also just like character building about reading a really difficult text. Like to spend the time going like back over in it and over it and over it and over it. And there's I think Kant, maybe more than any other figure that I can think of, elicits a response from me when I read him when I read them over and over and over and over again, that is like pretty genuinely dialectical, pretty close to like a real dialogue with, I don't even know who it's with. Is it with Kant? Is it with myself? Is it like with the ideas themselves? Is it with the logos? Where I go through waves, and my sense is like if you're making progress on Kant, my sense is you're probably going to go through these waves as well. You'll make a first pass and you'll be like, what the hell was that? I have no idea what he was talking about. You'll hear me explain some stuff. You'll go back, you'll read through it again, and you'll be like, oh, I see what's going on. That moment is temporary. Because you'll get a little bit more, you'll talk to other folks about their interpretations of Kant, you'll go back and read again, and suddenly all of those things that were clear, you're going to be like, oh, wait a minute, oh, it just slipped away again. But it's a better confusion than the first confusion. Like, suddenly you're seeing tinier problems, right? You're seeing, like, finer-grained issues in the work. And then if you work real hard and talk to other folks who are also at that stage, things will get clear again, and then you'll work harder, and things will get obscure again. And it's just kind of like round and round and round and round and round. And some folks might think, like, well, what's the point? You never actually get any clarity. But, like, you're having a conversation, right? You're having a conversation with the text. And your confusions are successively better and better and better. I like this. It never closes the conversation down. Plato was also really, really good at this, especially in the aporetic dialogues. This way, like, he wrote as a dialogue, which makes it easy to dialogue with him and with yourself as you're reading the text. And also kind of, like, leaves most of these dialogues with a big question mark hanging over it. Like, I'm not sure exactly what Plato thought. I'm not sure exactly what conclusion we were supposed to reach from this. Therefore, it stays alive. You can keep coming back to it. You can keep getting more. Speaking of Plato, Kant is also this figure. Here's, like, another reason why I might be such a bastard to make you read this really, really difficult stuff. I mentioned, like, it's character building. It's training in, like, how to really read. How to really engage a text so that you're having, like, a genuine conversation with it. How to, like, we talk about, have I mentioned this scene in Good Will Hunting before? There's a movie called Good Will Hunting. It's with Matt Damon and some other people. So Matt Damon and Robin Williams, they have a scene where Robin Williams says to Matt Damon, Will Hunting, says, who are your friends, Will? And Will says, I got plenty of friends. And he's like, I mean, like, people who really challenge you. And he's like, yeah, I got, like, a whole bunch of them. Will is this kind of boy genius janitor from, like, the rough neighborhood in Boston. And he starts going down a list. And he says, Kant, Nietzsche, Locke, Pope, O'Connor. And then Robin Williams comes back and he says, yeah, but those people are dead. You can't really, like, have a back and forth with them. Interesting point. Bullshit, I say. You can totally have a conversation with these people. These people can be your interlocutors. It just takes a certain sort of trick to, like, engaging the text in a real honest way, to not, like, read through it, shut the book, and be like, I got it, and, like, walk away. You have to keep coming back. You have to keep wrestling with the ideas. And the good writers write, perhaps, this is maybe one version of a good writer. One version of a good writer is somebody that allows the text to be that thing for you. Okay. I mentioned Plato and that he was particularly good at that too. Also, another reason to maybe, like, bring up Plato today is that, and another reason why it's important to read Kant is that he's just this unavoidable figure in modern philosophy. The same way that Plato and Aristotle are unavoidable figures in ancient philosophy. We can tell the history of philosophy in lots of different ways. And this is one of the challenges of teaching a history of philosophy course, is that you have to figure out, like, all right, so what story am I going to tell? Which things am I going to include in that story? Which things am I going to leave out of that story? Because there's important stuff that we're leaving out. We're not reading Berkeley. We're not reading Leibniz. We're not reading Spinoza in the first half of the class. We're not reading Hegel. We're not reading Marx. We're not reading Machiavelli, which maybe belongs in this conversation as well. So there are all sorts of things that have to get left out, and the story is going to get told in a particular way. But there are certain figures that it's just kind of like you can't leave them out. And the reason why is because it seems like everything before these figures, everything before these events in, like, the history of Western thought seems to be feeding into this moment, and everything after it seems to be emanating from that moment. One of those moments is this kind of back and forth between Plato and Aristotle. And another of these moments is what's going on between Hume and Kant. Everything before it seems to be feeding into this moment. Everything after it comes after. There's like before Plato and Aristotle, and then there's after Plato and Aristotle. And if you've taken an ancient philosophy course, you know that like philosophy becomes something distinctly different after that. And the same thing happens between Hume and Kant. Philosophy just becomes something distinctly different after this moment. So it's really unavoidable. There's no honest way to tell the story, I think, without this moment. Also, it's last but not least, I think he's right. I think at the end, like, as much as I could say that without claiming to understand what he's saying, I think he might be really right about this stuff. Okay. We should just what? We should just watch Good Will Hunting? You are more than welcome to. It's a fine movie. It won an Oscar. Oh, you guys are bright, morally flexible young undergraduates. It not being on Netflix doesn't stop you. Right. I'm not sure if it counts as theft, by the way, because you don't deprive the owner of, like, you don't take it away from them. We'll talk about this a little bit when we talk about lock-on property, because, like, I don't know if intellectual property can work as property. All right, let's start here. We didn't read beyond section 5 in Hume's Enquiry. Do we have some sense of, like, are we all feeling relatively comfortable about, like, what was happening in Hume's Enquiry? I hope so, because you have a writing assignment. It's the last one that I'll give you. I might slip one in for Kant that'll be optional. If you're just looking at the other reflection drafts and you're like, I got nothing, I'll be like, well, we got this last one on Kant if you want to do it. You could do that one as well for your the thing that you're going to submit before spring break as your first final draft. If we had gone like all the way to the end, to section 12, part 3, this is how Hume finishes off the Enquiry concerning human understanding. He says this. When we go through the... I decided to write this whole thing out for some reason. When we go through the libraries convinced of these principles, what havoc must we make? If we take in our hand any volume of divinity or school metaphysics, for instance, let us ask, does it contain any abstract reasoning about quantity or number? No. Does it contain any experiential reasoning about matters of fact and existence? No. Well, commit it then to the flames, for it can contain nothing but sophistry and illusion. That's a bold thing to say. Burn those books. Burn, like, and we're talking, do we see the kind of the familiar pattern here? We got abstract reasoning, we got matters of fact. Those are the only two sorts of knowledge that there even could possibly be. And by the time Hume's done, we get this sense that like the matters of fact thing is a little wonky too. It doesn't seem to be grounded in anything. There doesn't seem to be any reasoning in it. There's no justification that would get us to the point where you would say, like, yeah, we have justified true belief. We have, like, knowledge. We have something that maybe is sentiment, custom, feeling of certainty that a bunch of impressions seem to come together all the time, so I have a feeling that in the future they're probably going to come together as well. It seems to be, like, just maybe even an accidental quirk of the way that our psychology works. This is, after all, an enquiry concerning human understanding. And this might not be all that surprising. Locke was up to a similar sort of project where he said, this is an essay concerning human understanding, right? And both of them were talking in this way where it seems like they're trying to start the beginnings of what we would call a psychological science, a science of the mind. And all we need to do in order to determine that is, like, how do human minds work? And Hume seems to be right that, like, we just make these connections. And if you want to say, like, yeah, so that talks about how our minds do work, that might even describe the way that science does happen. That science is about, like, we see connections between impressions, or we see that they come together contemporaneously over and over and over again, so we start to get this feeling that we can expect them to be later, expect them to all come together later as well in subsequent circumstances. If we try to go beyond that and say, like, and this is grounded in like a well-reasoned justification, and this tells me something about not just the order of the impressions in my mind, but like what's going on out there in the real world, Hume says, like, ain't gonna happen. You're not gonna get that. So metaphysics itself, which is this the kind of the paradigmatic example of the hard philosophy that he talks about in section 1 of the Enquiry. He opened up with this question of, like, What space is there for this style of philosophy, this hard philosophy that perhaps tries to talk about things that, like, it's not just relations between ideas. It's not just abstract reasoning about quantity or numbers. And we're not talking about matters of fact stemming from experience. That would be science, an empirical science. What then of metaphysics? Well, commit it to the flames. Burn the books. Get rid of them. It's junk. This is one way of reading Hume. It's not a very difficult way to read Hume. This is a pretty bold and unambiguous way to end the inquiry. And Kant takes him at his word. Kant is engaged in... he's responding to Hume. And he's responding to Hume, like he's genuinely responding to Hume in this way that he points out that, like, not everybody does. Some people just dismiss him. Some people look at his arguments and they say, like, there's got to be, like, I don't like the conclusion, so there's got to be something wrong. They go out hunting for the problem. They find something that they're like, he's a little sloppy here. So, like, we can ignore everything that Hume said. We can disregard Hume's argument because it's uncomfortable and because I found something that allows me to, like, not believe it anymore. I don't know if that process feels familiar to you. I know this is how I read sometimes. It's not a very good way to read, I would say. Kant says, I'm responding to Hume, and I'm responding to Hume in a genuine way, in this way where, like, I get the problem that he's laying down. Hume wrote the inquiry, what was it, 1748? Is that right? I don't know if anybody has it in their notes. 1748? Still got it, Rosenfeld. 1748, and Immanuel Kant writes his Critique of Pure Reason in 1781. The Critique of Pure Reason is a big doorstop of a text. Part of the reason why it's a big doorstop of a text is because there are two critiques of pure reason in almost every volume of the Critique of Pure Reason. In 1781, he wrote a version that we call the A version today, and then in 1787, he basically went through and rewrote the whole thing, almost word for word in some places, kind of doing other things in other places, which is a fun little challenge to, like, have an A version and a B version where you're tracking and saying, like, where does he change his mind or where does he, like, say things differently than he did the last time. So in 1781, he writes the Critique of Pure Reason. In 1787, he writes it again. We get the B version. And in between those, in 1783, he writes the Prolegomena to Any Future Metaphysics, or Any Future Metaphysic. Similarly to David Hume, he finds that the Critique of Pure Reason is too clunky. People aren't really reading it, or they're not really getting much out of it. So he writes the Prolegomena for, you know, a more user-friendly, sort of popular audience. He says that his audience for the Prolegomena is like teachers, basically. Like all teachers. If you want to have some understanding of, like, what metaphysics is, whether or not it's possible, because this is the question that he engages in responding to Hume. This question of, like, is metaphysics possible? Or maybe even this question of, like, what would metaphysics have to be like in order to be possible? Hume seems to have some answer. He says, like, no, not in any kind of worthwhile sense. And Kant is dissatisfied with the gloominess of that conclusion, but he can't deny the compulsion that, like, Hume's argument comes with. He takes Hume at his word and says that, like, Hume gets it right, except for the last bit, except for perhaps this part. Section 4 of the inquiry, like, he totally nails it. He gets it right. Kant's not interested in dismissing that argument. He wants to embrace it and says, like, this is interesting. This is fun. Now we have a challenge. A serious challenge. How can we get out of this situation where Hume has put us, where, like, the ground has dropped out from underneath us? Science seems to be, like, roaring along, doing just fine, but apparently it has no ground. It's not about anything else in the real world. There's no continuity between metaphysics and science. Is metaphysics even possible? And he says this, the phrase that he uses is in the Critique of Pure Reason is that, in the introduction, is that Hume awakened him from his dogmatic slumber. And should have awakened all of us from our dogmatic slumbers. If you're a legit philosopher, Hume should bug the hell out of you. And you you should recognize that, like, he's got a really good argument, and it needs to be responded to. Not dismissed, responded to, engaged. We need to kind of, like, work within this problem that Hume has laid out for us. Garrett. Yeah, so metaphysics, which is this cluster of questions about, like, what is the reality beyond the appearances actually like? Hume, unsurprisingly, is just like, well, don't do that. That's, like, you can't do that. Like, that can't be done. But also, yeah, Garrett, you're right. Natural science also is, like, hanging in the balance here. Or natural science as we understand it. Natural science, in any sense, beyond what Hume's skeptical solution to the skeptical problem is, which is just accept that this is nothing more than feeling and custom. That natural science is a product of this little quirk of our psychology through which we seem to want to expect things to be like they were in the past, that we're susceptible to habit and custom. And if somebody were to say to you, like, that's all that science is, by the way, it's just habit and custom, we might say, like, oh, come on, it's a little more than that. It's a tool for understanding the world. Understanding the world as it really is, right? There's got to be some kind of connection there. And Hume's like, no, not really. And this is surprising, given that we've had, like, almost 100 years of uninterrupted, like, wild success from the natural sciences. Although, who knows? Like, maybe tomorrow it'll be different. If he'd stuck around until the beginning of the 20th century, Kant would have been like, ha-ha! See? Or Hume, actually, would have been, ha-ha! Kant actually would have been a bit more confused. So is natural science possible? Kant also does another funny thing here in the Prolegomena where he says, like, mathematics is on the line as well. Which is a little surprising because Hume would be inclined to say, like, mathematics belongs to that, like, abstract reasoning. It's just relations between ideas. And Kant is like, not so fast. Mathematics might be, when we do mathematics, when I discover a mathematical truth, it seems like some of us want to believe that, like, we didn't just discover something about the way that a symbolic game works. We discovered something about the way the world is. Plenty of people today argue, this is maybe one of the more contentious aspects of the Kantian program here, is like, what's up with mathematics? Is it analytic a priori? And Kant's like, no, it's something else. And a lot of mathematicians, philosophers of mathematics will be like, what'd you say? All right, so Kant is responding to Hume. He has this question, is metaphysics possible? We'll see as we go along that, like, natural science is on the line as well, mathematics is on the line as well, and in fact, the order of exposition that he offers through the Prolegomena is kind of backwards from this. He says, like, this is our goal, to figure out whether or not metaphysics is possible. First, I'm going to talk about the possibility of mathematics, then I'm going to talk about the possibility of natural science, and by the end, we'll get to the possibility of metaphysics. So that's the last thing that we'll be talking about when we talk about Kant, is we'll be getting into whether or not metaphysics is actually possible. And we'll take those steps, those little stops along the way. One of the interesting things that goes on in this Kantian writing style, in addition to, like, all of the other stuff, and I realize I'm kind of jumping all over the place. That's going to be today, by the way. I'm not going to be engaging the text too terribly closely. I'm really just, my goal for today is give us an overview of what Kant is up to. After all, the reading assignment wasn't due by today. Some people started reading. My sense is not everybody, most people haven't read at all, haven't done the reading quiz yet. That's fine. You should start because it's a slog. Like, you can't knock it out in the hour before class. You may as, like, if you are tempted to, if you're thinking, like, oh, I have an hour, I'll try to read Kant. Don't. Like, go feed the squirrels. Like, do something more productive with your time than try to read Kant in an hour. Like, it takes way more time than that. And you need to read carefully, slowly, and you need to reread in order to get really anything out of this. But one of the interesting things, this kind of technique that he has, is in different places. Come on in. That's all right. I know. I saw you there. In different places, he'll describe the same idea from a very different perspective. He'll kind of say, like, here's an idea, and then he'll kind of, like, elaborate it. He'll kind of do this exposition of, like, here's my idea. And then he'll say, or we could say it this way. And he'll say it this very different way. And it's so different, in fact, that you might be sitting there scratching your head and saying, like, how is that even the same thing? And then I'll say, you want to look at it another way? Let's look at it this way. And again, you're just like, how is that the same thing? And one of the tricks to trying to figure out Kant is to try to recognize like all the different places where he's claiming to say the same thing multiple ways. Figure out like how are they, in fact, the same way. For example, some of us, those of us with, I think, with any sort of exposure to Kant at all, probably know him from his ethics, specifically in the grounding of the groundwork for the metaphysics of morals, where we have the categorical imperative. The categorical imperative. There's one. It's one idea, and he articulates it in several different formulations, including act always such that the maxim of your action could be willed as universal law. So kind of like that's a fancy way, and this is a almost like a violent reduction. Ask yourself, what if everybody did that? And if like that's going to be a problem, if this leads to like a conceptual contradiction, then that's against the absolute moral law. He also says, treat others in such a way as you always treat them as an end in themselves and never as a mere means. And we might say to ourselves, like, basically this is like, don't use people for your own devices. Like, understand that they are humans too, that they have their own wills, and allow them to exercise their own free will. And he says, that's the same idea. It doesn't sound like the same idea, but understanding Kant is understanding how like they are the same idea. That it's like we're just unpacking the second one out of the first one, or we're unpacking them all out of like a single concept. So what I'm going to be doing today is I'm going to be, with what time we have left, what I'm going to be doing today is I'm going to give us two really kind of sketchy passes at what Kant is up to in the Prolegomena and in the Critique of Pure Reason. If you are just made of spare time, and if you're a philosophy major, I would recommend this maybe stronger than if you're not a philosophy major. I posted some links through the earlymoderntext.com site that Jonathan Bennett is running and that we're getting almost all of our texts from. Links to the Critique of Pure Reason. It's the same book, just much longer, and he goes into way more detail. If you're reading through and you're thinking to yourself, like, he's moving too fast, I want more detail, then go check out the first critique. It's called the first critique, because there are two other critiques that come after it. There's a critique of practical reason, and then there's a critique of judgment. Don't be surprised, however, if delving into like the finer details in the Critique of Pure Reason doesn't actually clear things up. It maybe just raises more questions. But that's, like I said before, that's the charm of Kant, the German charm of Kant. All right. So he's responding to Hume, this question, is metaphysics possible? And I said, I'm going to take a couple of passes at what I think Kant is up to in this project. Two passes, in fact. And maybe even three, if we have a little bit of time. It won't even be much of a pass. I'll just like pop a sentence on the board and say, like, this also. Like, if you can understand what this sentence means and understands how it's the same thing as the other two things, you're doing pretty good as far as understanding Kant goes. The first thing that I want to talk about is this question of synthetic a priori. This is one way of understanding what the Kantian project is all about, this search for synthetic a priori. And this begins with Hume's fork, remember? What was Hume's fork again? It was that there are only two kinds of knowledge, like even conceptually possible. Yeah, yeah, relations between ideas and matters of fact. And Hume never used this language, but I was, you know, trying to lay some groundwork. I was trying to plant some Kantian seeds early on. When we talked about relations between ideas, I said these are analytically known. Do we remember this? And we're kind of familiar with this term at this point. And that they are known a priori. And all we mean when we say that these are analytic statements is we say the predicate of the statement, the concept of the predicate of the statement is already contained within the concept of the subject. So you don't have to go outside of the sentence to figure out whether it's true. This is why they're called, yeah, true by definition. This is why they're called analytic. All you need to do is analyze the concepts at work, and you'll be able to determine whether or not this is a true statement. And because they are analytic, they are knowable a priori. That's two words, by the way. That's a priori. To the prior, right? Before. It just means before. And the, what is it? It's before? Before experience, yeah. So these are knowable before any experience. I don't have to actually meet any bachelors or vixens or squares, yeah. I don't have to know anything about any of those. I just need to know what the concept entails. That's right. I need no experience with squares whatsoever in order to know that squares have four sides. I just need to know the definition. I just need to know what the concept involves. Let's move on that, because as I walked over here, John, it was like picking up your screen. So just beware. Yeah. All right, so Hume's fork gives us relations between ideas and matters of fact, and we say that that's it. That's it. And he's saying the same thing over there in, at like the end of the inquiry. It's like, these are the only two things. Something tries to like slip in through the middle. We say like, that's not real knowledge. It's just sophistry and illusion. It's just people talking. It's all of the worst stuff that he was saying about the hard philosophy in section one of the inquiry. That it's just obfuscation, right? It's just people talking in as confusing a way possible to try to hide the fact that they're not saying anything. He's not saying, he's not exactly saying that there would be no such thing as knowledge. He might be saying that. If there was such a thing as knowledge concerning matters of fact, it's just not grounded in anything. This quote-unquote knowledge is a product of habit and custom. And you might be inclined to say, like, well, that ain't knowledge, man. Like, that's, knowledge is justified true belief. And Hume would be inclined to say, like, all right, if that's what you want to say, then yeah, there is no knowledge of matters of fact. But we certainly have ideas. We have beliefs concerning matters of fact. We can talk about the truth or falsity of these things. We can talk about the degree of compulsion you feel to believe them, the strength of the association in your mind between the like so-called cause and the so-called effect. If the strength of that association is so strong that you're just like, it's gotta, the effect has to come along with the cause, then sure, I guess like we'll call that knowledge. That seems to be what science does. But just don't make the mistake in thinking that that's grounded in any sort of metaphysical reason. Matters of fact are not analytic. They are synthetic, with the idea here being that I'm making a novel connection between subject and predicate. The concept of the predicate is not already contained within the subject of the subject, within the concept of the subject. And so this linking up of the two is something novel, is something new. There's a synthesis being done. And they are a posteriori, we said. And do we get this sense of like how it is that like maybe analyticity and syntheticity and a priori and a posteriori, like they're not saying exactly the same, like this is not exactly the same as this, this is not exactly the same as this, but shoot, man, they seem like they just go together. If something is analytic, if there's a statement that is analytic, it seems like it's knowable a priori. I can tell whether it's true or false just by examining the concepts. I don't have to have any experience. Does that make sense? This is important, so I see people spacing out. Like, wake up, come back to me. Do we get how these two things seem like they have to go together? Do we get how these two things seem to have to go together? If you're going to make a novel synthesis of two ideas, two impressions, and say, like, these come together, it has to be something that happens through experience. The only way to not do it through experience would be if it were true by definition, if it were analytically true. And Kant says, David Hume, you're right. Everybody, David Hume's right that if this were the case, if these were the only two things, then yes, metaphysics would be impossible. But I think there's something else. Because at least in the logical space of possibilities of like combinations of all these terms, it seems like we can start to maybe switch them up a little bit. We can say something like, why not? Well, let's start with analytic a posteriori. Nobody really ever talks about analytic a posteriori statements. Like, why not? Well, possibly because they're silly. If something were true by definition, why would I have to turn to experience in order to, like, confirm it? Does that make sense? Yeah, perhaps, but that's just like that would just be a convention, right? Yeah, so it would be a convention for what the symbols mean. But one of the things that like we have to sort of believe, and I totally get if there are like some people who have some familiarity with some philosophy of language or just kind of like linguistics in general that might be inclined to say like this, you can't pull this stuff away from the actual symbols or the actual sounds that we use. But it seems like one of the things that both Hume and Kant are operating under the assumption of is that you can separate these things. That it's one thing to make the noise, bachelor, and then another thing to define it. Bachelors are unmarried males. That was all like this auditory phenomenon, right? I spoke it, you heard it. I could write it out. Those would be different symbols. And both Kant and Hume seem to be under the impression that like there's conceptual content that is not related to the sights and sounds of the symbols. Does that make sense? For example, I wouldn't even have to know that, like, I don't know, like...
Yeah, you went over this in the last...
Yeah, I did go, yeah.
Every glimpse of
Lorb
or whatever, doesn't,
yeah.
You didn't have to exist to know, like, definitively.
That's right, yeah, yeah, yeah. Yeah, you remember it, okay, yeah. So, yeah, same sort of thing is going on. So, where was I? Oh, yeah, I was saying that it's at least a logical possibility that I might try to pair up analytic and a posteriori, but frankly, it seems kind of silly. It would be overkill to try to confirm the analytic, it would be overkill to try to confirm the truth of something, of an analytic statement through experience. Yeah. On the other hand, synthetic a priori, that is tempting. Something really interesting would be going on with a synthetic a priori. This would be genuinely new knowledge. Not just like moving symbols around. Not just unpacking the content of a concept. Not just analytic statements, which have a tendency to be a little bit empty, right? I don't learn anything new about bachelors by saying like, oh, they're unmarried males. If I knew what the concept of the bachelor entailed in the first place, then I would already know that they were unmarried males. When I say all squares have four sides, it's not so much that like there's anything new that comes to me there, it's that I'm just unpacking the definition. And I perhaps could even do some mathematics. I could say like not only do squares have four sides, they have four angles too. And you might say to yourself, did I learn anything new there? I don't know if I did. Maybe I just said the definition in a slightly different way. There's a sort of vacuity to analytic statements that kind of verges on tautology sometimes. All bachelors are male is really not all that different than all bachelors are bachelors. It is what it is. Boys will be boys. All of those things that don't mean anything. But a synthetic a priori, that would be something. If metaphysics were possible, by the way, it seems like it would have to be something that was genuine knowledge, like I came to something new. It was knowledge about the world. And I could come to it without experience, without any kind of particular experience. Knowledge about the world that isn't gained through experience. That's what a synthetic a priori would be. And Kant says, yeah, this is possible. This is totally possible. And the entirety of the project of at least the first half of the Critique of Pure Reason and an awful lot of what's going on in the Prolegomena, we can just kind of drop under the heading of Kant elaborating on what it means to say that synthetic a priori are possible. Synthetic, like, knowledge that is both synthetic and a priori, that, like, this is a thing that you can have, and if you can have that, then you can have metaphysics. I'm not going to explain what that is just yet. Yeah, he gives lots of examples. Yep. And you'll encounter some, like, right away. Right off the bat, he jumps right into it, and this is in his discussion of like how pure mathematics is possible, and it starts with space and time. Space and time seem to be what he calls pure intuitions, the form of all intuition, and therefore are like our prime example of synthetic a priori. Things that like there's nothing necessary, there's nothing analytically necessary about space and time. but yet I seem to already have space and time already at work before I have any experiences at all, so therefore it must be prior to experience. And this is starting to drift into like the second version. So yeah, let's handle some questions. Garrett.
Doesn't this basically work us back around to, we can just take experience and throw that out? We don't need that if we can like come to it without experience. Aren't we kind of moving backwards innate ideas and like?
Yeah, like so. This is a. Yeah, this is an excellent question to be asking. Like, is Kant talking about innate ideas here when he talks about synthetic a priori? And he's talking about something that's similar, but maybe not exactly the same. I've noticed in some of the writing assignments on Reflection Draft 2, which I'll be doing a short video that looks at some submissions on that, hopefully soon, as soon as I get some time this week. Some of the more interesting, the ones that I found the most interesting engagements with that question were folks who were starting to get into territory of talking about innate capacities and kind of saying, like, I'm not sure if that counts as an innate idea, but it seems like perhaps we are born with innate capacities, and Kant seems like maybe he's drifting into this territory as well. So we might think about these synthetic a priori as something that, I don't know if I would call them innate ideas, but it might be productive to think about them in terms of innate capacities. And the reason why we might think that they're innate, and Kant doesn't like embrace this language of innateness, but it seems like they're necessary. They're necessary in order for experience to happen at all. This is, in fact, I'll even drop this here, and this is maybe the bridge between these two accounts that I'm going to give. We're going to be talking about the necessary conditions for, and I'm not tall enough, experience. If we're talking about necessary conditions for experience, these things have to be prior to experience. But if those necessary conditions of experience aren't analytically contained within the concept of experience, if they're only analyzable by turning inward and having a critical attitude towards the workings of our own mind, then it seems like we're hot on the trail of the synthetic a priori. I can already smell it.
But if we're doing all this prior to experience, like, how can you make me, like, pretend towards turning inward when you get, like you're basically saying, like, an infant has this ability.
That is not the expectation. Kant is not saying that, like, anybody, with like a newborn infant would be able to like spin out the Critique of Pure Reason all on their own. He's like, no, goodness, no. They couldn't even read it. They couldn't even like understand it. Like this is not the suggestion. The suggestion is you have to have already had experiences to even begin thinking like this. But what you will discover are things that seem like they must have been there before experience. And therefore, that would count as knowledge? Maybe? Something? Yeah. What's that? Yeah, and we might also raise questions. I was talking to John earlier about this, about like we're going to encounter similar sorts of things when we're thinking about the state of nature, this myth of the state of nature and the social contract when we get into the political material in the second half of the semester, and how like it's not clear that this is meant to be taken literally, that this is a chronological history of how societies happen. First, state of nature, then we all come together and we say, like, let's make a social contract to get out of the state of nature, because it sucks. I don't think we should read anybody, like not Hobbes, not Locke, not Rousseau, like any of the folks who talk about this. I don't think we should read them as literally saying that this is a history of how societies happen. And I'm not sure that we should be reading Kant as talking about like this is the order in which he's not necessarily prescribing like a mechanism, or at least it's ambiguous. It's ambiguous how he means. When Kant talks about like priority, even like a priori, like prior to experience, does he mean like temporally prior? Does he mean logically prior? What's going on? So this is like one of the big mucky quagmires that like happens in Kant, is this question of like, in what sense is he talking about priority? And sometimes we'll get the sense I was talking before, how he like will describe things in different ways. The account of this that we get in the Critique of Pure Reason and the Prolegomena seems to be this kind of like building up process where it starts with intuitions, what Hume would call sense impressions, and then goes on to like explain how it is that we develop concepts and how it is that we develop more complicated ideas out of that, similar to what Locke was doing as well. But then in other places, much later on in his life, he seems to tell the whole story, but like backwards. And it's not clear like which way was it supposed to go. And one of the confusing and elegant kind of like almost satisfying things about Kant is this way in which we might come to this conclusion, like it doesn't matter. Maybe the problem is to like think of it in some sort of chronological order. Maybe there's something to like this kind of incredible coherence of this story that like you tell it forward, you tell it backwards, it really doesn't matter. It's the same story that kind of tells us that like, ah, this maybe, this is what makes it all hang together is perhaps what makes it true, what makes it believable. There also might be some circularity involved there, but then again, it might be virtuous circularity. All right. So necessary conditions for experience. I'm going to do the other part over here, and I'll erase some stuff. I'll erase this big fat Hume quote. Here's another stab at what Immanuel Kant is up to, and you'll notice, similar to this version of what he was up to, that like kind of pretty much starts out with Hume, and then like goes on for a little while, and you might be thinking to yourself, like, this is Hume. And I'm like, yeah, this is Hume. This is Kant says, he's responding to Hume in a very honest and genuine way, and then kind of like makes one little twist. This version, instead of calling it synthetic a priori, well, maybe I'll call this is the Copernican Revolution version. Version of like what Kant seems to be up to. He refers to what's going on in the Critique of Pure Reason, the big conceptual breakthrough, and what he's trying to represent in a shorter, more concise way in the Prolegomena. As a Copernican Revolution. Now, the Copernican Revolution already happened well before Kant. We all know, in fact, we talked about this. This is one of the first things that we talked about in this class, right? It was the Copernican Revolution and Galileo and how he got into all kinds of trouble, and that this is a background for what Descartes is up to in the Meditations. Remind me again, what's the Copernican Revolution? That the Earth goes around the sun. Yeah, it's a heliocentric model rather than a geocentric model. This shift, and like, I don't know if I did this at the time. I believe I tried. I don't know if I convinced you that, like, this is an incredible shift in perspective. The sort of thing that, like, we perhaps take for granted today to think to ourselves, like, how, like, the amount of mental flexibility that is required in order for you to go from thinking that the Earth is the center of the universe and everything revolves around it, saying, like, no. Something else is the center, or perhaps there is no center, and the Earth moves. This is one of those things that you might not actually be able to make that jump. That the only way that like a society makes that jump is like all of the geocentric folks, they just die eventually, and all of the heliocentric folks just eventually, they take over because they're younger and spryer and not dead yet. So Kant is talking about a Copernican revolution. So what he means by this is like such an incredible shift in perspective that it's the sort of thing that is like really, really difficult to ask people to do. This is one of the great barriers to understanding Kant, is that he's talking about such a massive shift in the way that you conceive what reality is, what the world is, like what metaphysics is up to in the first place, that some folks just don't actually make the leap. And you might be thinking to yourself, like, yeah, but surely, like, it's been a long time since Kant wrote all this stuff, so, like, perhaps we have made the leap. No, because it's so hard. It's so hard to read that, like, some people, like, well, some philosophers have made the leap, but the message doesn't really manage to get out to everybody else because it's a very difficult message to convey. All right, so this Copernican Revolution, how shall we think about this? Well, here's one way to think about it. Okay. Ah, good, yeah, very good. Do you guys enjoy it when your professors try to draw?
No.
Is it relaxing?
It's more
Kind of like a little Bob Ross moment. Just put a happy little tree right there. Yeah, that's right, yeah. I'm in the wrong business. So we have, obviously, a tree here. The most beautiful tree on campus, in fact. So we have this tree here, and then we've got a person. And the person perceives the tree. How does that happen? Well, you don't know how big the rest of them is. Might be a small head. Smaller than my head. Maybe I've got a big head. This is beside the point. How does the perception happen? How does this person begin to perceive this tree? Don't be shy. Don't be shy. I'm gonna say that you're wrong eventually, no matter what you say. But like, yeah, so start me off here. Photons, where did they come from? From the sun, yeah, good. Like, we're all good Platonists. It all starts with the sun. With the form of the good. And then the sun, the light comes and it hits the tree, and then what? Reflects off the tree, and then it reflects off the tree, what, towards the head, specifically towards the eye. Yeah, we're going to need an eye in order for this person to see the tree, and not just an eye like the ego cogito, but we need an eyeball as well. And we'll get the tree with just one. For two, we get depth perception as well, but yeah. So all of these rays of light, or photons, if you want to be a particle theorist about it, go into the eye, and they go through, there's a lens, I think I remember, and then the image gets inverted, and it's on the retina, and we also talked about, like, there's a risk of a big homuncular problem now, because now we've got this little upside-down tree image, and the question is, like, well, who sees that? Like, a little person inside the brain? Like, that's gonna be a problem. But something like this happens, right? That then this gets into our mind brain, and I see the tree. Okay. I see the tree in here. Like, the sight is happening in here. Is that right? The sight doesn't happen out here. Sight happens in here. If we're going to follow somebody like David Hume, and even like most of our empiricist friends who are going to talk about this stuff, they'll say something like, some impression, Hume called that an impression, some impression gets made on your mind, your brain, if you want to think about it in materialist terms. Some impression gets made, and then you have ideas of that impression, the ideas are faint copies of the impression, blah, 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 blah. That's the Humean story. Which means that all you're ever going on, like all you ever think about, are things that are going on in here. This tree out here, off limits. You never have any direct contact with the tree. You only have access to your ideas about the tree, or impressions that the tree creates on your mind. And the big Humean issue was that, like, I try to articulate necessary connections between sense impressions such that I'll kind of like put them all together and I'll say the way that like all of these sense impressions that I'm experiencing right now when I'm looking out at the tree, when I say that I'm looking out at the tree, I bind them together and I say that they have this necessary connection by virtue of belonging to some substance, right? Something that I call the tree. That's more than just a combination of like a bunch of sense impressions. It's a thing. And Hume is basically saying, yeah, there's a firewall between what's going on in your mind and what's actually going on out in the world, and you can't make that jump. And Kant says, yeah, you're right. The way that Kant describes this is he says, this side of all this stuff, he calls this, these are noumena, or this is the noumenon. This is the noumenal world. These are, the phrase that he'll use, these are the things in themselves. And Kant says, Hume is right, they're off limits. He won't go so far as to say there are no things in themselves. He'll just say, you can't know anything about them. Just let it go. That's the trick to getting past Hume, is to like not try to hold on to the things in themselves out there in the noumenon. Just say, like, forget about it, it's gone. And you might be thinking to yourself, but Kant, I thought you said we're going to get to do metaphysics. I thought you said we're going to ground natural science. We're going to say that like these ideas that we have are somehow like connected to reality. How are we going to do this if we just cut the noumena loose? What all that's left is this stuff on the other side, what Kant calls phenomena. These are the phenomena. Noumenon comes from the Greek word, from that root nous. Pesky little word, that nous. Never really sure exactly what it means. But noumenon basically means it's the object of your knowledge. Your knowledge is always supposed to be like knowledge of something, and the noumena is that object that your knowledge is of. This is the suggestion that it's like it's the objects correlating to your knowledge. Phenomena is like appearances. It comes from phainai, the Greek word phainai. So these are appearances. And Kant says, yeah, let's make this distinction. Hume never put it quite like this, but let's make this distinction between phenomena and noumena, and let's just agree with Hume that, like, noumena is off limits. It's gone. Just cut it loose. All the most that we can say about it is that, like, there's stuff. There's a world. Maybe we'll say there's a world out there, but you're never going to say anything about it. You're never going to be able to say anything with any kind of confidence about it because of all of the problems that Hume has brought up, that we only have access to the impressions that the world makes on our mind. And all of our attempts to make sort of necessary connections between those impressions such that they correlate to real things out here, the things in themselves, this is just foolish. It can't be done. And again, the question is, well, it seems like we've answered your question here that, like, is metaphysics possible? Like, the answer is, like, no, then it's not possible. And Kant says, not so fast. Whoever said you can only do metaphysics about this stuff? Why can't you do metaphysics just thinking in terms of phenomena? And one of the distinctions that he makes, and this is going to be another important distinction, and this is not going to clear up anything in this project, but hopefully it'll introduce enough terms so that like you have a little bit of structural furniture in your mind that as you're reading, you'll kind of like see these moments, you'll be like, ah, there it is. He's talking about that thing that Rosenfeld talked about on Tuesday. Kant is recognizing that like when these sense impressions come in, and it's tempting. I'll use this as kind of like a first draft of your understanding of what Kant means when he talks about intuitions. Now blow up what's going on in the mind brain there. You might think of Kant's intuitions as roughly equivalent to, at least to start off, as roughly equivalent to what Hume is talking about when Hume talks about impressions. So intuitions are this kind of, it's the sensory impressions or non-sensory impressions. It's all of these impressions that kind of come into me. And the big distinction that Kant wants to make here when he's talking about, like, how is it that we might be able to do metaphysics that deals solely with phenomena, such that we might be talking about synthetic a priori knowledge, is to recognize that these intuitions, this is not experience yet. You haven't had any experiences if all you have are intuitions. And we've touched on this idea previously in class when we were talking about this question of, if you had no innate ideas, for example, how would you even begin to make sense of the world? So if you want to think about intuitions or impressions that are not yet experiences, you might think in terms of what's going on with a newborn baby, like the first sights and sounds that it gets. And like, don't try to like impose like the way that you make sense of the world on this newborn baby. Recognize that like it's got nothing just yet. Nothing has been done to these sensory impressions that are coming in. It's just going to be chaos. It's going to be like colors and sounds and just like blah! What's that? What's this thing here? Do we recognize it? It's a case. It's a case for a tablet. But you have to know, you have to have a concept of case and tablet in order to know this, right? So let's get, before you've like figured out that like, oh, that's a case, try to get back to like, no. What was the impression on your mind? What were the intuitions before you like identified this as a case for a tablet? It's red, but in order to know that it's red, you need a concept of red. You might even say it's rectangle. Like, it's a red rectangle thing, and we'll say something like, you got to have the concept of red, and you got to have this concept of rectangle. Don't even get me started on thing, because that's a weird idea, too. That's substance. Before that, like, there's no experience. It's just chaotic sensory noise. Then the intuitions get organized. They get organized through some sort of mental apparatus, through concepts. Intuitions get organized through concepts, and only then can we have an experience. So impressions are not experienced just yet, because these, what Kant will call intuitions, like they don't constitute experience. You need to make sense of your intuitions, of these kind of sensory impressions, before we can say that any experience has happened. This process of organizing the experience by subsuming these things under concepts, this is the work that the mind does. This is where we're going to be focusing our attention into like the way that the mind works, and presumably this is where we're going to find our mythical synthetic a priori.
So that's
that. Yeah, this is not exactly that, because concepts, we might say to ourselves, like, but wait a minute, you're not born with any concepts, right? This would be innate ideas now if you were born with concepts, and Kant is going to be like, yeah, you're right, you're not born with concepts. You develop concepts from regularities in your experiences, and then we're going to say, like, how could you begin to make concepts if you need concepts in order to have experiences? And like, yeah, I'm with you right there. That's a puzzle. That's a serious puzzle. But somewhere in this process of organization, not necessarily concepts, this is where we may very well find our synthetic a priori. Because remember exactly what the synthetic a priori were. These are the necessary conditions for experience. So yeah, sure. Some kind of input. That's a necessary condition for experience. The intuitions are a necessary condition, and also the stuff that's going on in here. And this might be part of the way that we might even kind of recognize that he might just be pulling a terminological fast one on us, although I'll say, I don't think that that's all that's going on. He might say that all of this stuff is prior to experience because, look, here in this procedural chain, experience is way down here. So anything that we can figure out, like, upstream of experience, that's going to be a priori. But it's not just a clever terminological trick, I don't think.
So people can have the same phenomena occur when having an experience and
have
their concept organized.
Wait, say again?
People can have the same, like, phenomena.
The same. Phenomena is, like, everything that's going on this side of the divide. Right. That's true. And if there were differences, if you experienced it in a different way than I did, then my guess is the things that made my experience different than yours, those aren't going to be necessary conditions of experience. Obviously, they're not necessary because they could have been otherwise. They were otherwise in your experience. But there are some things that are going to be the same in everybody's. Not just every human's experience, by the way. But anything that could have experiences at all. Insofar that, like, thinking is possible, thinking is going to have to work in a certain way. And this, Kant says, like, this is, like, I don't know what you're looking for in reality beyond something like that, something that has to be the same for everybody. And we were like, but I want it out there in, like, the world, in the noumena. And Kant's like, sorry, grow up. Like, that's gone. You can't have it. Hume was right. You can't have it. But that doesn't mean that we can't talk about reality. It doesn't mean we can't talk about things being quote-unquote objective. It doesn't mean that we can't do metaphysics. It doesn't mean that we can't ground natural science and even mathematics, if you believe him about mathematics, by looking at the way that any sort of experiencing mind has to work in order for experiences to happen at all. What do you mean? How does it ground us?
I don't follow as to like how it actually bothers me more, because like it's saying we need some sort of organization of intuition in order for experience to work. How are we like? First off, like if we can't ever see the noumena, like how can we even say that we get experiences, because all we have are those intuitions?
Well, we might go back to kind of like a Cartesian argument here and say, like, well, I obviously have experiences, right? I mean, if I didn't have experience, then I'm having a false experience of having an experience. Oh, I'm having an experience.
Then also, like, how does that ground us with any further belief?
Yeah, the ground is weird, right? You thought that the ground was solid beneath you. You thought that the ground was, like, something that didn't move. You thought that the ground was out here and not in here. Copernican revolution. It's almost vertigo inducing to say, like, think of reality as like not just the appearances. We're not, by the way, I am not saying that reality is subjective, that everybody gets their own reality. Reality is the same for everybody. It's just not out here. At least insofar as metaphysics could be done, there cannot be any metaphysics of the reality out here. If we're buying Hume's problem, and Kant most certainly is, then the only way that like metaphysics, a grounding of the natural science or mathematics can be done such that we can say that it has some contact with reality, that has some contact with like objective truth, if we want to use that sort of language, is it's going to be in all of like the necessary ways in which intuitions get organized into experience. Not just for humans, but for anything that can have an experience. You might think of like aliens too, right? If intelligent aliens landed on Earth today, Kant would say like, yeah, Kant's not thinking about aliens, but at one point he does say, if God could think, then this would be how God thinks as well. Well, this is day one of four, so like, yeah, we're gonna get into the details, and I'll let you judge by the time we're done whether or not he's kind of explained how it's done. But don't expect a mechanism. That mechanism would be also, incidentally, the mechanism would be like, if you're looking for a view from outside, looking in, which is kind of what I've done here, like don't expect that either. Because we have to do this process from the inside looking in, right? We have to be examining our own thought process and trying to figure out, is there anything that seems to be necessary about it, such that it is a necessary condition for experience? Well, the bell just rang. I think that means that, like, we got to stop. So no further questions. No, we're going to have three more days of this. By our next class, make sure that you've read the introduction and the first part. The part on the possibility of pure mathematics. Our next meeting is going to be on the possibility of pure natural science. The next meeting is going to be on the possibility of metaphysics.